And he entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. And they watched him, whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he saith unto the man which had the withered hand, Stand forth. And he saith unto them, Is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days, or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they held their peace. And when he had looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he saith unto the man, Stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. And the Pharisees went forth, and straightway took counsel with the Herodians against him, how they might destroy him. But Jesus withdrew himself with his disciples to the sea. And a great multitude from Galilee followed him, and from Judea, and from Jerusalem, and from Idumea, and from beyond Jordan, and they about Tyre and Sidon, a great multitude, when they had heard what great things he did, came unto him. And he spake to his disciples, that a small ship should wait on him because of the multitude, lest they should throng him. For he had healed many, insomuch that they pressed upon him for to touch him, as many as had plagues. And unclean spirits, when they saw him, fell down before him, and cried, saying, Thou art the Son of God. And he straightly charged them that they should not make him known. And he goeth up into a mountain, and calleth unto him whom he would. And they came unto him. And he ordained 12, that they should be with him, and that he might send them forth to preach, and to have power to heal sicknesses, and to cast out devils. And Simon he surnamed Peter, and James the son of Zebedee, and John the brother of James, and he surnamed them Boanerges, which is the sons of thunder, and Andrew, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, and James the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, and Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, which also betrayed him. And they went into an house. And the multitude cometh together again, so that they could not so much as eat bread. And when his friends heard of it, they went out to lay hold on him, for they said, He is beside himself. And the scribes which came down from Jerusalem said, He hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of the devils casteth he out devils. And he called them unto him, and said unto them in parables, How can Satan cast out Satan? And if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan rise up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand, but hath an end. No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he will first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. Verily I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of men, and blasphemies, wherewith soever they shall blaspheme. But he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation, because they said, He hath an unclean spirit. There came then his brethren and his mother, and standing without, sent unto him, calling him. And the multitude sat about him, and they said unto him, Behold thy mother, and thy brethren without seek for thee. And he answered them, saying, Who is my mother or my brethren? And he looked round about on them which sat about him, and said, Behold my mother and my brethren. For whosoever shall do the will of God, the same is my brother and my sister and mother.
Thanks, Dave. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you once again for the opportunity to come into your house and open your word. And Lord, I just ask you to come upon me in power right now, Lord, that you would fill me with your spirit, you would enable me to speak your word clearly and accurately. Lord, I just ask you to give each one of us an understanding of your word. Help us to be changed by your word. We ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Now, last week, if you remember in Mark chapter number 2, we saw there was multitudes of people that they were trying to get Jesus, remember, because they saw his healing power, they wanted to be near him. It kind of continues on in this chapter. We also saw him at the end of chapter 2, he was correcting people's false doctrine. Remember, they had false doctrine concerning the Sabbath, You know, that they complained because his disciples, what were they doing? They walked through the fields and they plucked corn and they ate it and they were finding fault. Well, it's kind of the similar sort of theme happens as we continue on in this chapter where people have a problem with, in this case, it's actually Jesus himself healing on the Sabbath. So let's just jump in, verse number 1. Mark chapter number 3, verse number 1. It says, and he entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. So he enters into the synagogue, and it's interesting, we didn't read it there, but in the next verse we discover that it was on the Sabbath day. Look at verse number 2. They watched him whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day. So when Jesus went into the synagogue, that was the Sabbath. And I suppose we know from looking at other places, that was Jesus' custom. On the Sabbath, what would he do? He would go into the synagogue. Keep your finger there in Mark, but look at Luke chapter number 4. Luke chapter number 4 and verse number 16. Luke chapter number 4 and verse number 16. It says, and he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. So where would you find Jesus on the Sabbath? In the synagogue. That was his custom. That's where he went. And so here we see he enters into the synagogue on the Sabbath. But in this case, he meets this guy who's got this withered hand. So think about a withered hand. If it's withered, it's basically, if something's withered, it's like it's sort of shrunken. It's shriveled up. It's kind of useless. You know, I remember one time I had a student who had a hand and it was just curled up like that. You know, and I worked with computers and all the stuff she did, she had to just use one hand. All the stuff she did, because it just sat there, it was just withered, it just couldn't do anything, and so that's what she had to do. So this is this person that he meets there, he meets this guy, and he's got a withered hand. Look at verse number 2, and they watched him, whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, and don't forget, look at the last part of the verse, that they might accuse him, that they might accuse him. So some people, they're watching him, they're trying to see whether he's going to heal this man, because obviously, as we've seen, chapter 1 and chapter 2, he's been healing a whole pile of people. You know, there was a guy with palsy, there was a leper, there was Peter's mother-in-law, there was many sick and possessed with devils all over the place. He's been healing people. But what they're doing, they're watching to say, are we going to accuse him of something? Because it's on the Sabbath day. And it's interesting because, I mean, there can be a tendency to find fault. It can be. I mean, isn't it very easy? It's very easy to find fault, to notice things that are wrong. I mean, I know I'm like that. I can easily spot something that's wrong. I mean, all these things are right, but that thing's wrong. All these things are right, but that thing you can easily spot. And it's kind of a tendency we need to be fighting against. It's almost like we could do with doing the opposite of that. We could do with actually looking for something that's right and say, well, look, these are the things that you did. Well, this is a good thing. Notice that thing that was done that was good, because that's something, instead of criticizing, we can actually praise. You know, and that's a good principle, especially to bear in mind with children. You know, think about how children respond when you praise them for what they're doing well. They're going to want to do more of that. But I mean, the tendency to be was just, well, I just overlook those things, and then when they do something wrong, to jump all over that. Then, apart from the fact that it's going to discourage them, but also there's the thing that, you know, children like attention, and if the only time they get attention is when you're doing things that are wrong, it's like, okay, well, they'll act up and they'll do more of that because they're going to get some attention one way or the other. You know, to jump in verse number 3, it says, and he saith unto the man which had the withered hand, stand forth, stand forth. So, no doubt, Jesus knows exactly what they're up to. He knows that they're actually looking to find fault with him, but he tells the man to stand forth. In other words, what he's going to do, he's not going to go and, like, heal him off secretly, quietly. He says, stand forth. In other words, get right out here in public so everyone can see it. But notice also that the man has to do something. Okay, he says to the man, stand forth. He's not just an uninvolved bystander. Jesus just didn't go up and heal him. Jesus says to the man, stand forth. The guy has to do that. Okay, look at verse number 4. It says, and he saith unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days or to do evil? To save life or to kill, but they held their peace. So Jesus said, look, is it right to do good or is it right to do bad? And what do they say? They say nothing at all. You see, Jesus says to those, they're looking to accuse him. He says, is it right on the Sabbath? What should you be doing on the Sabbath? Doing evil or doing good? And basically, they don't answer him because everyone knows what's the answer to that question. Is it right, you know, should we do good? Should we do right on the Sabbath or should we do evil? Everybody knows, and so they don't want to come out with it, and so they say nothing whatsoever. Well, look at Jesus' reaction, verse number 5. And when he had looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he saith unto the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. So notice, Jesus is angry, and it says he's specifically angry because of the hardness of their hearts. So does Jesus like it when people have got hard hearts? No, he doesn't. Okay? Now, there's a number of things we can learn from this. Yeah. One of the first things we can learn, is it a sin to be angry? No. Why? Because Jesus was angry. Jesus was angry. And if it's a sin to be angry, that would mean that Jesus is a sinner. But of course, we know that Jesus is not a sinner. Look, if you would keep your finger in Mark 3, but look at 2 Corinthians chapter number 5. 2 Corinthians chapter number 5 and verse number 21. 2 Corinthians chapter number 5, verse number 21. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he hath made him, that's talking about Jesus, to be sin for us. Remember, Jesus took upon him the sin of the world. He hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin. So did Jesus know any sin? Did Jesus have any of his own sin? No. He hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And it's about the exchange that takes place when someone gets saved. Is that, you know, Jesus has taken our sin upon him, but not only that, he's put his righteousness upon us. Look, if you would, at 1 Peter chapter number 2. 1 Peter chapter number 2 and verse number 22. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse number 22. Talking about Jesus again, it says, who did no sin? Who did no sin? Neither was guile found in his mouth. So Jesus never sinned. Jesus never, ever sinned. I mean, even, you know, in the Gospels you can read, even Pilate. Now, was Pilate a friend of Jesus? No, he wasn't. You know, the Roman ruler. But what did he say about Jesus? He said, I find in him no fault at all. You know, so even Jesus' enemy, even the guy that, you know, ordered him to be crucified, what did he say? I find no fault. He's done nothing wrong. I find no fault in him at all. Turn if you to Ephesians chapter number 4. Ephesians chapter number 4 and verse number 26. Ephesians chapter number 4 and verse number 26. Ephesians 4 number 26, page 1181. Ephesians 4 verse 26 says, be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. So notice that. The Bible says be angry, but don't sin. So therefore, you know, we can tell from that again that being angry is not necessarily a sin. But it does give us a sort of a warning here. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. So it says actually, don't stay angry. Don't remain angry. I mean, we can all get angry from time to time, but should we stay angry? Should we let it, you know, fester? No, definitely not. It says, let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Because although it's not a sin to be angry, often our anger can be sinful. It can be sinful, and it can actually lead us to sin. It can lead us to sin. Don't you turn there, but James chapter number 1, verse number 20, it says, for the wrath of man, that's the anger of man, worketh not the righteousness of God. Remember that next time you're angry, and think, I'm going to get angry. Is this going to work God's righteousness or not? You know, there can be lots of things that can cause us to be angry, but they're not always necessarily righteous reasons, okay? Now, just turning back to Mark chapter number 3, there was a reason that Jesus was angry. There was a legitimate reason why Jesus was angry, and the reason was because of the hardness of their hearts. Now, just think about this for a second. You know, there's a false teaching around called Calvinism. A lot of people believe this teaching of Calvinism. And one of the things that Calvinism teaches is that God chooses everything. No such thing as free will. Everything's chosen. Everything's predetermined by God. Okay? Well, here's the thing. If that was the case, then these people with their hardened hearts, who would be the person who hardened their hearts? Clearly, it would be God who'd hardened their hearts. So what sense would it make if God hardened these people's hearts, and then Jesus, who was God, is getting angry because they've got hard hearts, because God made their hearts hard? Would that make any sense at all? It wouldn't make any sense. In fact, not only that, I mean, really, you know, I mean, because God is not a crazy person. You know, he doesn't cause someone to do something and then get angry at them because they've done it. Would that make sense? You know? And so we need to understand that about God. In fact, if it really was God that hardened their hearts, if God had done it, it was God's will, and then you got angry about that, wouldn't that be sinful? It would. You know, if God does something, you're mad about it, it's like, you know, you're going against God. That's sinning, okay? And so that would actually make Jesus a sinner, because he would be angry at these people with hard hearts whose hearts God had hardened, okay? So it's a silly sort of idea. And the thing is, the error that many people make is because they say, well, because God did something once, therefore he always does it. Because are there examples in the Bible of where God hardens someone's heart? Yes, there are. There are examples where God hardens people's hearts. You know, one, probably the first one that springs to mind is Pharaoh. Remember, the Bible talks about how God, it says God hardened Pharaoh's heart. But of course, Pharaoh also hardened his own heart. It wasn't just that God just did it. Now, what God did is, in the end, God hardened his heart, and he made it so that it just stayed hard, so that Pharaoh did just things that a crazy person would do. Yeah. I mean, you think about all the plagues that came down. Remember the 10 plagues? And it's like, you know, plague number one, plague number... And these different things are happening. You've got the lice and the locusts and the dark and all these different things. I mean, you get the idea, hey, you know, God is obviously with Moses. Let me just let them go. This is just not working, you know? And yet what happened? God hardened his heart because he wanted to show his, you know, his glory. And so he specifically, Pharaoh hardened his heart, but then God just said, right. And he took him to the stage where he was doing what no normal person would do. Like, Pharaoh's advisors were saying, let them go, let them go. And obviously in the end he did let them go, but then what happened? He chased after them. After all this had happened, the firstborn had been killed throughout the whole country. Let's chase after them. Great idea. But God did it to bring his judgment upon Pharaoh and his armies and all that sort of stuff. Okay? And so there are other people it talks about. For example, it talks about the Pharisees. There were Pharisees whose hearts God hardened. Look, if you would, at John chapter number 12. John chapter number 12. Wrong page. John chapter number 12. Verse number 37. John 12, verse 37 says, but though he had done so many miracles before them, yet they believed not on him, that the saying of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled, which he spake, Lord, who hath believed our report, and to whom hath the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore they could not believe, because that Isaiah said again, he hath blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, that they should not see with their eyes, nor understand with their heart, and be converted, and I should heal them. So here we understand, there are times when God hardens people's hearts, when he blinds their eyes, when he makes it impossible, because it says they could not believe. They could not believe. Now that's something, you know, the Calvinists will take that verse and say, well, there you go. That's why people don't believe, because God has to allow you. No, what they're doing is they're taking a false idea, which is they're saying, because according to the Bible, someone can reach a stage where God will eventually say, that's it. They've rejected God, and God says, that's it, I've had enough. And he can make it impossible for them to believe. Because that's what we just read. It says they could not believe. God was the one who blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts. But that doesn't mean that every unsaved person, that's what the situation is. For most people, that's not the case. But it does happen. Some people have this idea that it's never too late for someone. It's never too late. Someone can always be saved. But that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that it can reach a point where God says, that's it. That's enough. It's too late. Okay? And I'm not going to go off into it now, but it's an important thing that we understand, that we need to understand that, you know, God does do that. But people will twist it and say, no, it's because God does everything. Everything that happens, it's because God does it. You know, I mean, what about this? Does God ever put people in positions of authority? Does God ever do that? Yeah, he does, definitely. He raised up the many godly kings that he raised up. For example, you know, King David, he raised up a godly king. But is every king put there by God? Now, according to, you know, Calvinism, according, you know, they talk about the sovereignty of God. Everything happens, it's because it's God's will. Well, that would mean that every king that's put there, God put them there. Like, you know, Adolf Hitler, he put them there. He's not a king, but he was a ruler. God put them there. Well, it says in Hosea chapter 8, verse 4, it says, they've set up kings, but not by me. That's what God said. They have set up kings, but not by me. You know? So God, yeah, he does put people in authority, but he doesn't put everybody in authority. Does God ever kill people? Does God ever kill people in the Bible? Yes, he does. God does kill people in the Bible. There's examples of God striking people dead. You know, I mean, in the New Testament, we read Herod, he was struck by God. Struck by God, and he killed him. Nabal, we read when we were going through 1 Samuel. Remember, God struck him, and he died. You know, he made his heart like stone, okay? But does that mean that whenever someone dies, God killed them? No, it doesn't. Often people die because of their own or sometimes other people's decisions, but often it's their own decision. I mean, look, if you were to keep your finger in Mark 2, but look at 1 Chronicles chapter number 35. 1 Chronicles chapter number 35, there's a very famous king of Israel, a very godly king, but it's interesting, in 1 Chronicles chapter number, I've got 1 Chronicles 35, I'm thinking of 2 Chronicles is where it must be. 2 Chronicles chapter number 35, it is indeed. 2 Chronicles 35, and Josiah was a very godly king. You know, it talks about how he kept a Passover, you know, and he was like this. He did things, let me have a look where it is. I didn't write the verse down, but it says, you know, killed the Passover, verse number 11. Verse 17, and the children of Israel that were present kept the Passover at that time, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, 7 days. There was no Passover like to that kept in Israel from the days of Samuel the prophet. Neither did all the kings of Israel keep such a Passover as Josiah kept. And the priests and the Levites and all Judah and Israel were present, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem. So look, Josiah is this godly king. He's going back to the old ways. We're keeping the Passover. He's doing these things. But then look at verse 20. After all this, when Josiah had prepared the temple, Necho, king of Egypt, came up to fight against Carchemish by Euphrates. And Josiah went out against him. So notice, the king of Egypt is fighting with who? Someone else. Someone else, somewhere else. He's in some fight. But Josiah goes out against him. He sent ambassadors from saying, what have I to do with thee, thou king of Judah? I come not against thee this day, but against the house wherewith I have war. For God commanded me to make haste. Forbear thee from meddling with God, who is with me, that he destroy thee not. Look at verse 22. Nevertheless, Josiah would not turn his face from him, but disguised himself, that he might fight with him, and hearken not unto the words of Necho from the mouth of God, and came to fight in the valley of Megiddo. And the archers shot at King Josiah, and the king said to his servants, have me away, for I am sore wounded. His servants took him therefore out of the chariot and put him in the second chariot that he had, and they brought him to Jerusalem, and he died, and was buried in one of the sepulchres of his fathers, and all Judah and Jerusalem mourned for Josiah. So here we see, he went into a battle that he had no business being in, and he got killed. He got killed because even though he was this godly, righteous king, one of the greatest kings that Israel had, one of the greatest kings that Judah had, and yet, lo and behold, an arrow shoots him. Now, there's another king, I'm trying to think of, was it Ahab, I think it was, who, remember, he went into a battle. He was king of Israel, and he disguised himself. But God had said, guess what, you're going to die. And it's like, lo and behold, the arrow goes through, and just through a chink in the armour. You know, he's got his armour on, he's disguised, so no one's even going to know that he's... But God says, you're going to die. And actually, I think it even says it was just by chance. Someone just drew a bow at a venture, just let off an arrow somewhere, and lo and behold, shot him, and he died. Okay? But that's not what happened with Josiah. It wasn't God saying, you're going to die. But at the same time, because it's like he took himself out from the protection of God. Because when someone's doing what's right, there are certain protections that God puts around them. It's like into a hedge. Remember when Satan was accusing Job? He said to God, haven't you put a hedge around him and all that he has? And it's true, because Job was a righteous man, he was protected, his family was protected, because he was doing what's right. There were certain protections that he had around him. Okay? But the thing is, when we go outside the hedge, what happens to the protection? It's no longer there. You know? And so we've got the choice to listen to God, or we cannot listen to him. So, just getting back to Mark chapter number 3, Jesus, what does he do? He tells the man, stretch forth his hand, and his hand is healed. He says, stretch forth his hand, and it was restored whole as the other. And notice even this, what would have happened if this guy had refused to... Jesus said, stretch out your hand, and he didn't. If he disobeyed, if he hadn't, what would have happened? Do you think his hand would just healed where it was? I don't think it would. I think he had to stretch out his hand. He had to do it.
Yep.
And when he was obedient, God performed the miracle. Verse number 6. And the Pharisees went forth and straightway took counsel with the Herodians against him, how they might destroy him. So the Pharisees and the Herodians, they plot to destroy Jesus because of what he has done. Because he's healed this guy. And think about that. They're against someone who does good. What's he done? He's healed this guy. And what are they doing? They're taking counsel against him, how they might destroy him. You know, in John, chapter number 11, remember the account where Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead? What happened after he raised him from the dead? They plotted. They plotted together, we need to kill Jesus. Because of Lazarus raising from the dead, many people are believing. And say, in fact, it says they plotted, and it says they wanted to even put Lazarus to death too. Wanted to do both of them, put them to death. Why? Because they didn't want people to believe. Okay, and so even though Jesus has done a good thing, they're you know, and you say, well, no one would do that though. I mean, when someone, if you do what's right, everything will be fine. There'll be no one against you. You know, I was just reading an account quite recently about this guy, a guy over in Tasmania. This guy was an orthopedic surgeon, and the guy, I've got his name here somewhere. Where is he? Dr. Gary Fetke, over in Tasmania. And he's an orthopedic surgeon, and a lot of the stuff that he does, a lot of his work is involved with amputations. You know, a lot of people have got, like, you know, diabetes and stuff like that, and he's, and you know, I mean, it's a very, it's a sad thing, but it's a common thing. You know, my wife's got an auntie that had to have an amputation because of complications of diabetes. And he says it's, you know, it's the part of his job that he hates. I mean, imagine going to work and you're chopping off people's feet and legs, and it wouldn't be nice. It wouldn't be nice. And so he ended up going through something where he actually got cancer himself, and he goes through, you know, trying, what can I do? And obviously, and he recommends, you know, following the various protocols and trying the stuff. But at the same time, you want to try whatever avenue you can. You know, and cancer is one of those things that doesn't necessarily just happen randomly. It doesn't. You look at world maps of cancer. Do you know what they are? They're maps of the Western world. You know, it is clearly associated with whatever's going on in the Western world. You know, and the most likely thing is dietary. You know, that's what's killing people in the Western world. Okay, and so what he discovered is he was able to put his cancer into remission by changing his diet, and he did a whole pile of research. And so what he did, he was sick of chopping people's legs off, chopping people's limbs off. And so he started recommending to his patients, you know, that they cut back on the sugar, massively cut back on the sugar. You know, they reduce, you know, carbohydrate in their diet. They, you know, and that was what he was saying to his patients. And do you know what was happening with his patients? They were finding success. You know, their blood sugar was going down to a normal level. They were coming off drugs. They were, he was fixing. Now, sometimes they still need the drugs and interventions, but it was dropping massively. You think, great, people are going to love it. But that's not what happened to him. Basically, he got reprimanded by the AHPRA, which is, I've got it written down here what it stands for, some Australian. It's basically the medical people who are in charge of him having a license to be a doctor. And basically they said to him, because, yeah, what it was, it says here, yeah, he got, this is what he was getting his patients to do, cut out most of the carbohydrates, increasing your protein, eating more meat and eggs, and, you know, good natural, the sort of healthy food you find about in the Bible. He was saying, do that, and guess what? It had good results. But what happened is basically he also noticed, he started pushing for changes because he noticed that the hospital where he worked, the food that they were giving him in the hospital, he's like, the food's full of sugar. It's like 30% sugar. Some, you know, crazy. I mean, you think it's strange. When my mother was in hospital, I looked at the stuff they were feeding her, and it was 30, 40% sugar. Yeah. That's what they were giving her. Yeah. It's like, strange.
Yeah.
But so he was saying, hey, look, this doesn't seem right. You know, you want to change this. And so he was basically investigated, and they said, you're not allowed to give dietary advice to your patients, you know, which seems strange. So you're a doctor and you're not allowed to give dietary advice. You've got to be a dietitian in order to do it. And he had these various complaints from anonymous, like he didn't know who they were. And this was a couple of years ago that was there. And he was basically not allowed to speak in public. He was not allowed to, you know, if he posted on Facebook, if he did anything, they said, be quiet. And if you're not quiet, then you're going to lose your license, you know? And now it's come out, and in the end, he's actually been cleared. It took a couple of years. But it's interesting that, you know, someone doing something good, do you think, what would be wrong with that?
Yeah.
Less people having their legs chopped off, people are going to be happy.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
There were people who weren't happy. There were people who weren't happy. Let's have a continue on. Let's see what Jesus does. Verse number 7. He says, but Jesus withdrew himself with his disciples to the sea, and a great multitude from Galilee followed him, and from Judea, and from Jerusalem, from Idumea, and from beyond Jordan, and they about Tyre and Sidon, a great multitude, when they heard what great things he did, came unto him. So Jesus, he withdraws himself and his disciples, but of course the people, they all follow him, because they've heard all the great things that he's done. Look at verse number 9. And he spake to his disciples that a small ship should wait on him because of the multitude, lest they should throng him. Now, this is interesting to note that Jesus, he sometimes put a space between himself and the multitudes. There were times when he did that. He put himself a space between himself and the multitude. It says in, don't need to turn there, but in Luke chapter 5, verse number 15, it says, but so much the more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear and to be healed by him of their infirmities, and he withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. So there were times when the multitudes were gathering around, and what did Jesus do? He withdrew himself. He went off into the wilderness and prayed. In fact, if you look at Mark chapter number 6, just over a couple of pages, Mark chapter number 6 and verse number 31. Mark chapter number 6 and verse number 31. And he said unto them, come ye yourselves, he's talking to his disciples, apart into a desert place and rest a while. For there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure so much as to eat. And they departed into a desert place by ship privately. So he's telling his disciples, come apart and rest. Come apart and rest. And the people saw them departing, and many knew him and ran afoot thither out of all cities, and out went them and came together unto Jesus. And Jesus, when he came out, saw much people and was moved with compassion toward them, because they were sheep not having a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. So in the end, they followed him, and he had compassion, and he went and taught them stuff anyway. He helped them anyway. But it's worth noting that Jesus said to his disciples, have some time apart. Have some time to rest. And that's a really important principle that we all should bear in mind. We need time to rest. We do. It can be so easy to think, I'm busy. I've got all these things to do, so I'm just going to be doing and doing and doing. Stop. You need to stop. You need to have a rest. You know, it's important. I mean, everyone's got different jobs. You know, students, you've got lots of hours. You know, working, looking after kids. You've got all these demands on your time. All these demands on your attention. But the thing is, we need to take time and stop. For our good, and for the people around us, for their good. You know? I mean, you think about it. There's two extremes. Think about with children. If you're looking after children, you could be a parent who gives no time to children. And their parents are just not interested. You know, I'm just on my phone all the time. That's all it is. It's just on the phone. Not interested. Oh, yeah, I'm on Facebook. I'm doing this. Aren't their parents like that? Is that what the kids need? Definitely not. But, of course, at the same time, you can also be a parent who all your time you will give to your children. From the time they wake up, you say, I never have any time for myself. Well, that's not something that's actually helpful for your children. It's not. They need to have time by themselves. In other words, take your children, read them a story, and then now you sit down and play quietly. Play by yourself. And children actually need that. I mean, I know with our kids, I mean, especially, you know, the youngest one, she needs time by herself. Now, she would be with people. She would be doing stuff all the time. But when she's by herself and plays by herself, it's like it calms her right down.
Yeah.
She actually needs that time. It's for her good. And it's for everyone's good. We need to be able to be occupied by ourselves. We need to do that. Take time apart. Take time apart. Okay, verse number 10. Remember, the multitude, they're thronging around him. For he had healed many, insomuch that they pressed upon him for to touch him, as many as had plagues. And unclean spirits, when they saw him, fell down before him and cried, saying, thou art the Son of God. Now, one of the reasons why so many people were crowding round about him was because he healed so many people.
Yes.
He cast out unclean spirits. And it's interesting that they knew he was the Son of God. They actually knew. Just as it says, he cast them out. They fell down before him and cried out, saying, thou art the Son. So the devils, they knew who Jesus was. And it's interesting that people who are associated with unclean spirits, you know, they know about Jesus. You even notice that. You could look at like the, you know, within music, there's a lot of satanic stuff.
Yeah.
Satanic music.
Yeah.
And what do you find with that? The people are into all the death and the gore and the death metal and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
There's references to the Bible.
Yeah.
All the way through it.
Yeah.
You know, I remember listening to, I used to listen to a band while I was young called The Cure. Now, I mean, looking back now, effeminate, they're probably homos or something, I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah. But I remember there's a song I used to listen to, and the words are something like, I'm paralyzed by the blood of Christ. Doesn't that sound like something demonic?
Yeah.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And yet there's lots of stuff like that. Now, at the time, I wasn't a believer. I didn't know anything about it. But there's plenty of Christians who listen to worldly music that's just full of just filthy lyrics.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, I mean, the guy from The Doors. You know, the guy from The Doors. He quotes about, you know, I'm going to, you know, a bird's going to pluck out my eyes. He's quoting from Book of Proverbs.
Yes.
You know? Anyway, it's interesting. Yeah, they know these things. Why? Because it's real. It's real. Verse number 12. It says, and he straightly charged them that they should not make him known. So Jesus, at this time, he didn't want to be known. Remember, because he had to be rejected. He had to be, you know, he had to be crucified. Verse number 13. And he goeth up into a mountain and calleth unto him whom he would, and they came unto him. And he ordained 12 that they should be with him, and that he might send them forth to preach. So Jesus chose 12 of his disciples to be apostles. Okay, it says in Luke chapter number 6, let's just check the reference, because there it just says he chose 12. But if you look in Luke chapter number 6, verse 13, Luke 6, 13, it says, and when it was day, he called unto him his disciples, and of them he chose 12, whom also he named apostles. That's where they get the name from. Jesus called them, he chose them and named them apostles. So he chose them, he ordained them to be apostles, and to go forth and preach. Now, it doesn't say that he chose his apostles to be saved. It says he chose them or ordained them to go and preach. Because once again, it's that false Calvinistic belief that, oh, God chose, that's why you're saved, because God chose you to be saved. No, I mean, a verse sometimes people use to say this is John chapter number 15, John chapter number 15 and verse number 16, John 15, 16. It says, and this is Jesus talking to his disciples, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. So people say, there you go, that's why you're saved, because God chose you. Is that what it says? It says, look, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you, that you should go forth and bring forth fruit, and your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he may give it you. So he chose them, and he ordained them. Why? To bring forth fruit, to go and preach. That's what he chose them. And who's he talking to? His disciples, the apostles, again. And yet, before we get to John chapter number 15, we come to John chapter number 6. Look at John chapter number 6 and verse number 70. John chapter number 6 and verse number 70. Jesus answered them, John 6, 70, have not I chosen you 12? And one of you is a devil. So were they all saved? No. He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. Why is it that Judas wasn't saved? Well, if we look back in verse number... verse number 64. But there are some of you that believe not, for Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who should betray him. So that was the problem with Judas. He didn't believe. He didn't believe. Yeah, Jesus chose him to be one of his disciples. He chose him to be an apostle, but he wasn't saved. Why? He didn't believe. And obviously, Jesus chose him because ultimately he was going to betray him. Okay? You know, turn back to Mark chapter number 3. Mark chapter number 3. Verse number 15. So ordained 12, they should be with him, he might send them forth to preach, and to have power to heal sicknesses and to cast out devils. So as well as ordaining them as apostles, he also gave them power to heal people. Now notice, this is not a gift that was given to every believer. It's not. It wasn't given to every believer. There were things that the apostles could do that other people couldn't do. Look, for example, at Acts chapter number 8. In Acts chapter number 8, in verse number 12, here we can see there were things that the apostles did that other people couldn't do. For example, laying hands on people and the Holy Spirit coming on them. Look at Acts chapter number 8 and verse number 12. Acts chapter 8 and verse number 12. It says, and when they believed Philip, preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. So Philip goes there, he preaches the gospel, they believe, they get baptized. Then Simon, who's a guy down there, Simon himself believed also, and when he was baptized and continued with Philip, and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. So Philip is doing miracles and signs, okay? But it's interesting to note here, now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John. So you know Peter and John, two of the apostles, who when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So notice, they were saved, they were baptized, but the Holy Ghost hadn't come upon them in power. Verse 17, then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. So the Holy Ghost came upon them in power, but only after Peter and John had come down. Only after Peter and John. Okay? And that's why there were signs, there were evidences of being an apostle. You know, look at 2 Corinthians chapter number 12. 2 Corinthians chapter number 12 and verse number 12. 2 Corinthians chapter number 12. And the apostle Paul, who also is an apostle, he was the last of the apostles, he says, is one born out of due time. 2 Corinthians 12:12 says, truly the signs of an apostle were wrought among you, or worked among you, in all patience, and signs and wonders and mighty deeds. So he says, the signs of an apostle, I did them. Because he was saying, look, guess what, I really am an apostle. You know, some of you guys think I'm not. I really am an apostle. That's what he's saying. Because the signs of an apostle were done. Well, that means that there were things that apostles did that other people didn't do. Because otherwise, if everyone did it, how would that be a sign of an apostle? It wouldn't, you know? It's like you hear people, they talk about saying, like the evidence. What's the evidence that someone's saved? What's the evidence that someone's saved? And people say, they came to church. Can you come to church without being saved? Well, I guess coming to church is not evidence that you're saved then, is it? You know? He cleaned up his life. You know, he stopped drinking. You know, he's turned from his sin. Well, I mean, can someone who's not saved give up drinking? Yep. Well, is that evidence then? No, it's not. Okay? So it's a crazy idea to say, what is the evidence? The evidence is what they say. Yeah. That's why we ask them, what do you believe? What are you trusting in? Oh, I'm a good person. That's why I'm going to heaven. Well, guess what? That's evidence that they're not saved because they're trusting in their works. But if they're trusting in Jesus' blood and that he died for all of their sins, that's the evidence. The Bible says faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. Notice that. Because you can see when someone comes to church. You can see when they give up drinking. You can see when they stop sins in their life. But can you see their faith? You can't really. You can't. But all you can hear what they say. And so based on that, sounds like they're saved. Or not, it's the case number. You know, turn back to Mark chapter number 3. Mark chapter number 3, look at verse number 16. Mark chapter number 3, verse number 16. So he gave them power to heal sicknesses and cast out devils. And Simon, whose surname Peter, and James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James, and he surnamed them Boanerges, which is the sons of thunder, and Andrew and Philip. Now, this is a different Philip. When we saw the Philip in Acts 8, who, you know, couldn't get the Holy Spirit, didn't come, he was a different guy. He was one of the first deacons. That was members of Stephen and Prochorus and Nicanor and those different ones in Acts 6. So they're different. Those were the deacons as opposed to these, the original apostles. Bartholomew and Matthew and Thomas and James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus and Simon the Canaanite. Interesting. No, some people have this idea that all of Jesus' disciples were Jewish. Well, Simon wasn't. He was a Canaanite. He was a Canaanite. And they say, oh, well, that's just where he lived. Well, they all lived there. They all lived in Canaan. So no, you know, Jesus wasn't a racist. He wasn't a racist, okay? Doesn't matter what, you know, background you're from. Look at verse number 19. And Judas Iscariot, which also betrayed him, and they went into an house. So, you know, we see the list of the 12 disciples. If you look in the other Gospels, you'll find that when you look at the list of names and compare them, you'll actually find that, you know, the lists aren't identical. And obviously because, I mean, part of the reason is because they had multiple names. You know, Simon, he called him Peter, and different ones had multiple names. And it doesn't help also, some of them got the same name, like there was, you know, multiple people called James, etc., etc. And as we said, yeah, that Philip, he was a different one. Look at verse number 20. And the multitude cometh together again, so they could not so much as eat bread. So the multitude surrounds them again. They don't even have time to eat. Verse 21. And when his friends, this is Jesus' friends, heard of it, they went out to lay hold on him, for they said, he is beside himself. So Jesus' friends are going to go out and lay hold on him, grab a hold of him, you know, and they say he's beside himself. When he's saying he's beside himself, they're actually saying he's gone crazy. He's gone crazy. You don't need to turn there, but in Acts chapter 26 and verse 24, it says, Festus said with a loud voice, Paul, thou art beside thyself, much learning doth make thee mad. So when he says he's beside himself, he's actually saying, you're mad, you're crazy. That's what they're saying to Jesus, you're crazy. You know, because why? He's just flat out doing things, not even having time to eat. Look at verse number 22. So his friends are saying he's mad, but then in verse 22, and the scribes which came down from Jerusalem said, he hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of the devils casteth he out devils. So the scribes take things even further. They accuse Jesus of being possessed by Satan. You know how he's got the power to heal these people? How's he got the power to do these amazing things? because he's got Beelzebub. That's Satan. You know, Baal. Okay, that's what they're saying. Look at verse number 23. And he called them unto him and said unto them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? And if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan rise up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand, but hath an end. So Jesus points out, look, this is a foolish thing to say. You know, casting devils out of people. Why would Satan be doing that? Why would Satan be destroying his own work? Obviously, it doesn't make any sense. Verse number 27. No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he will first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. So Jesus is saying, look, you know, the one that's able to cast out devils has to be able to have power over them. It has to be someone who's stronger than they are. And obviously, God is stronger than Satan. God is stronger than any devil, and that's where his power is coming from. That's how he's able to cast out these devils. Verse number 28. Verily I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of men, and blasphemies wherewith soever they shall blaspheme. But he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation, because they said he hath an unclean spirit. So Jesus warns them of the danger of attributing the work of God to Satan, the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost, which he's talking about here. I mean, these people saw Jesus perform miracles by the power of God. You know, they saw him heal people. They saw him, you know, they heard him teach. They heard him preach in the power of the Holy Ghost. They saw the Son of God. They saw God manifest in the flesh right before them doing these amazing things. And they said, he's empowered by Satan. He's empowered by Satan. So what they're doing is they're rejecting. I mean, what else could God do? What else could Jesus have done? He did all the miracles. He spoke. What more is he supposed to do? But they didn't want to know. Just like the ones when he raised Lazarus from the dead. We need to kill him and let's kill Lazarus. Wicked people. That's what they wanted to do. They rejected God. But ultimately, rejection of God leads to rejection by God. Rejection by God. And that's why it says, you know, if someone blasphemes against the Holy Ghost, they never have forgiveness. You know, and it says, I think it might be in Matthew 12, it says, not in this world, nor in the world to come. Yeah. Okay? Never having forgiveness. And so the Bible actually talks about people who have been rejected by God. It says in Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 30, reprobate silver shall men call them, because the Lord hath rejected them. It's when God gives up on someone, when he hardens their heart and says, that's enough, no more. When it's impossible, like we saw, impossible for someone to be saved, impossible for them to believe. That's why it's important for people to believe when they have the chance. Because if you reject and reject and reject, you don't know. You know? Someone doesn't know how long they've got. Look, if you would, at 2 Timothy chapter number 3. 2 Timothy chapter number 3 describes something about these reprobates. 2 Timothy chapter number 3. Verse number 1 says, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. Notice, despising people who are good. Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness. This is interesting. Having a form of godliness. In other words, they might be religious people. They might look godly to some degree. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof from such turn away. So that they've got this form of godliness, and it talks about that in 2 Corinthians 11, where it talks about, you know, Satan disguised himself as an angel of light. His ministers are like the ministers of righteousness. They disguise themselves. But he says here, denying the power thereof. What's the power of God? It says in Romans 1:16, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. So what do they do? They deny the power of God. They deny the gospel. What do they deny? That salvation is by faith in Jesus alone. That's what they deny. So you can see this religious person, you know, the Catholic priest who, you know, outwardly might appear, he might be religious, he might appear godly, some of them, but denies the power. He denies the gospel. He says you've got to work your way to heaven. You've got to pray to Mary. You've got to say your rosary. You've got to confess to the priest. You've got to do all these different things. And he says here, it says, from such turn away. From such turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins, led away with divers lusts. Kind of reminds you of the Jehovah's Witnesses. So they creep into houses and lead captive. He says, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. They're rejected. They're rejected. But notice also, they're resisting the truth. Because Jesus, what was he doing? He was preaching the truth. That's what we saw in Mark chapter number 2. He's telling, here's, this is what the truth is. In Mark chapter number 3, he's telling what the truth is, but they reject it. They reject it. They don't want to know anything to do with it. Look back at verse number 31. Mark chapter 3, verse number 31. Mark 3, verse 31. There came then his brethren and his mother, and standing without, sent unto him, calling him. And the multitude sat about him, and they said unto him, behold, thy mother and thy brethren without seek for thee. And he answered them, saying, who is my mother or my brethren? And he looked round about on them which sat about him, and said, behold, my mother and my brethren. For whosoever shall do the will of God, the same is my brother and my sister and mother. So Jesus' family come to him, they call for him, but when people tell him, hey, look, your family's here, what does he say? My real family are those who do the will of God. That's what Jesus is saying. My real family is these people, the disciples that are gathered around me. That's who my real family is. And the fact is, for the believer, that's who our real family is. That's, you know, we're a church family. And it's important that that's what we should be, a church family. You know, that's with brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so. Why? Because we're a family. And he says, look, my real family are those who do the will of God. Notice that, who do the will of God. Because it's great to hear the word of God. But James says, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. He says, for if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deeds. So we shouldn't just be hearers, but also doers. It says in John 5:24, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word, what do we have to do? And believeth on him that sent me, hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. What is the will of God? What is it that Jesus' family, his brother, his sister, his mother, what is it that we do? Well, John 6:40 says, and this is the will of him which has sent me. This is what you have to do, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him at the last day. So what we've seen in this chapter, we saw at the start, remember Jesus got angry with people. Sometimes it's okay to be angry. You know, it says in Psalm 7 that God is angry with the wicked every day.
Yeah.
And as we saw, it wouldn't make sense. If God had predetermined their wicked deeds, you know, for him to be angry about it, it would be daft. But is it a wicked thing to not want someone to be healed? That's wicked. What was the motivation behind it? Well, I mean, they wanted their power. They didn't want their power to be undermined. You know, they were clinging on to their power. And, you know, they saw themselves as being the source of spiritual truth. But the multitudes, they were flocking to Jesus. Jesus was healing them. You know, he was teaching them. And so what they do, they said, you know, that his power, and by implication his doctrine as well, where is it from? From Satan. But Jesus said, look, if any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. You know, if something's right or not, do what God says. God's saying this, do it, and then you'll know if the doctrine's actually right. Last place we'll turn is Proverbs chapter number 3. Proverbs chapter number 3. Proverbs chapter number 3. You see, we saw Jesus, he got angry. But the reason he was angry, the hardness of their hearts, but also because Jesus had compassion on the guy with the withered hand. He had compassion. It says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 3, let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck, write them upon the table of thine heart. So shall thou find favour and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Compassion, mercy, as well as truth. These people were unmerciful. They were uncompassionate. And they didn't have the truth either.
Yeah.
Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, I pray you'd help us to learn from your example. You're a man of compassion. Help us to have compassion. You're a man of righteous anger. Help us to have righteous anger. When things are being done unjustly, when people are hard-hearted, who reject God and reject the truth and have no compassion and pity on others, help us to be righteously angry and help us to stand for the truth. We thank you and praise you and love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.